They are lying to you about menopause. So let's say you go to your doctor around the age of 48, could be 38 or as late as 58, but with a series of symptoms that your peers are actually experiencing, but rarely likely to discuss at cocktail hour, let alone in front of any male within earshot. It's kind of maybe like a weakness to discuss this stuff. Well, if you're a woman, you're highly likely to be labeled as crazy, when in fact, there's solid medical basis behind what you were feeling. And I did say scientific. Menopause does not have an algorithm into which we can fit this, so the medical community becomes confused. Think symptoms like brain fog, changes in sexual function, weight gain, weight redistribution. I see all the time in my clinic, more weight down near the lower area, less up top, new onset or worsening of depression, anxiety, bipolar, ADHD, risk for heart disease, diabetes, recurrent urinary tract infection. That's a more obscure one. And how about this one? Shoulder pain, frozen shoulder. How about joint pains? Neurological symptoms. So when you go to the doctor, no wonder they can't put this into one category, but in fact, it should be, because it's all tuned in to your hormones. You're not crazy. And unfortunately, at this point, well, it's at the point where it's not bombastic to say you are being lied to. Let me explain today, because over 1.3 billion women are going through this exact scenario right now. Oh, and I'll share with you my top 4 natural strategies to combat this change and to help you navigate it. We always want natural first. You see, the number one demographic coming to see me in my clinic is age 40 to 60. I've been at this for almost 30 years, so my practice is mature, kind of like me. So today's topic is deadly serious, because what 90% of my patients are really saying to me is, I'm seeing aesthetic changes and I don't like it. What they really mean is, I'm entering or I'm in menopause. That's what they're saying. They're seeing the changes to their face, but really it becomes a conversation about menopause, hormones, and yes, they say they feel invisible. What does that mean? Well, many of you know, but for those who don't, if you walk down the street and you're not noticed, you're not paid attention to, like maybe you were 10 or 20 years ago. I never knew that term until my patients taught me. Yeah, doc, invisible. I feel invisible. Like I don't garner the attention I once did. That's another way of saying it. Shocking and sad, but not their fault. It's our fault as a medical community that's failing people in discussing hormones. And let's do everything we can naturally, of course, like I always say, to maintain your hormone status for as long as possible. Keep that in mind, for as long as possible before you need to think about supplementing it, because at some point, often you will. It just is the case. Natural is always better. And at the end of the video, I'll post a link to a video all about hormone replacement therapy and bioidentical hormone replacement therapy, so that when you get to that point and you want to research it, I made this video and it's about 40 or 50 minutes, but it's going to be one of the best investments of your time. I can assure you that. The top 4 practices I'm going to tell you today are so important because the symptoms of menopause last forever. You see, menopause is for the rest of your life. Sure, some things are temporary, like hot flashes, the night sweats, even the brain fog can be temporary and improve, but pretty much everything else is going to continue to progress in a very linear fashion. Look at this graph of bone loss over time. The bone loss doesn't get better, it's linear, it declines. And so initiating these practices sooner rather than later is important. Now let me really shock you. 85% of women complain of menopausal symptoms and 10.5% are receiving treatment or therapy. So 85% of people have symptoms. 15% of you are going to say, I'm breezing through it, no problem. But of those with symptoms, only 10.5% are receiving treatment or any type of therapy. Parallel that to any other health condition that affects 50% of a population. Over 1 billion women, almost 1.5 billion women are affected by it today. So it is a certainty. All women, if you live long enough, will experience this. It's not if, but when. And you may say, well, let's look at other mammals to get some data. Let's look at animal models of other species. But guess what? Human females are the only of a few, a handful of species on Earth that experience this. If we look at women's hormones over time, do you see the cliff right here around 50? Look at men's, and herein lies the issue. You see, women aren't taken seriously. You see, your ovaries shrink. You have the amount of eggs you're going to have from birth, and then by 40, 45, there's almost no eggs left. Parallel that with a man that's producing sperm continually for the rest of his life until the day he dies. There's a distinction between the ovary and the testicle. And men can get their testosterone and maintain it. I took mine within the last year, and I hadn't done it in 10 years, and I was slightly higher than I was 10 years ago. Now, I follow a more strict diet. It's not that strict, but it's way stricter than I did 10 years ago, and my activity levels are more structured and much more different than they were 10 years ago. So there's changes that I made, but you see, a man declines slowly over time, but doesn't have that cliff and that drop off. So there's a distinction here, and it's part of the reason I believe why this isn't very well studied. In fact, women suffering from menopause pop into their doctor and they're more likely to be prescribed an antidepressant for their menopause than hormone therapy. And they're more often, as I said, labeled as crazy. It's akin to seeking gardening advice for a dying plant. And instead of addressing the soil quality or watering it, the expert suggests change the color of the pot. See what happens. It's a cosmetic change that doesn't nourish the plant back to its health, but there's something to do in the meantime to say, give that a try and move on. So who's the really crazy one here? I think it, the medical community. So with all this in mind, here are four top strategies I adopt for my patients and I want you to know about today. Number one, I see it so commonly, women don't eat enough protein. You want to eat enough protein at every meal. Consuming adequate amounts of protein is extremely important. So many patients I see do not, especially women. And I've never really known why this is or where this narrative come from. I'm wondering if maybe women don't feel that well after they take protein in, whereas males seem to gobble it down. They're eating hot wings and steaks. You see, not only does protein provide essential amino acids that your body can't make on its own, but your body also needs it to produce protein-derived hormones, also known as peptide hormones. These are becoming more popular, so you'll know that name now, peptides. Your endocrine glands make these hormones from amino acids. Your take home here, eat a minimum of 15 to 30 grams of protein per meal. Assuming 3 meals a day, that's if you're mildly active. As you increase your exercise, you're going to need to increase your protein from there. Number two, engage in regular exercise. This is one I can't stress enough. I know when all those systems are off kilter, how do you get the gumption to go exercise, right? It's kind of like a crescendo effect. But exercise can negate the negative effects of so much we do. All of our sins, so to speak, indulgent foods, a little too much alcohol in a while, a little less sleep once in a while, a late night. Exercise balances all of these indiscretions. It's that important. Think of exercise as the eraser for your health transgressions. If it came in a pill and it was available for sale, guaranteed it would be thousands of dollars, be worth a Bitcoin. It's that good. Physical activity strongly influences your hormonal health. Aside from improving blood flow to your muscles, exercise increases hormone receptor sensitivity. That's key. So your receptors for your hormones become more sensitive and act more on the hormones you do have. so it enhances the delivery of nutrients and hormone signals. Here's a key point to understand. You see, regular exercise, it improves your insulin resistance independently of your body weight or fat mass reduction. So what does that mean? That means if you're not seeing the tens of pounds that you want gone from exercise, don't worry, it's still working. It has a systemic response that you can't see. If you're exercising, you're not losing weight. Well, you want to look to your diet a little bit to see what you're taking in. But other than that, it's still working. You're still getting more hormone response from the hormones you do have because the receptors are in a way upregulated. Moreover, being physically active helps boost levels of muscle-maintaining hormones that decline with age. Think testosterone, IGF-1, DHEA, growth hormone, HGH. Some of these are familiar to you, or you're supplementing with them. Now, I did say IGF-1. You see, IGF-1, or insulin-like growth factor 1, is a hormone that manages the effects of your growth hormone in your body. Together, IGF-1 and growth hormone promote normal growth of bones and tissues. Your bones are oh so important. You want to keep your bones. Now, here's one I hear a lot. Doc, but I can't perform vigorous exercise. Well, good news for you too. Even regular walking boosts key hormone levels, improving strength and quality of life. This is study and proven. So whatever you can do, whatever level of fitness you have, it's helping you. But there's more. I have a video on exactly what exercises women need to do, and this is studied. It's based on the Lifmore trial that helps maintain your bones through exercise, and it looked, and there were 3 key exercises that were beneficial to women. You want to watch that. I saw 3 patients last week that had osteoporosis, not osteopenia, where there's a little bit of bone gone, but full-on osteoporosis. That's devastating. Don't let it happen to you. Number 3, maintain a moderate weight. This is a huge, no pun intended here, issue in North America especially, but don't worry, it's not just us, it's becoming global as countries adopt our westernized diet. That's what you want to get rid of, your westernized diet in a sense. Weight gain is directly associated with hormonal imbalances that lead to complications in insulin sensitivity and reproductive health. But there's more. You see, obesity is also associated with hypogonadism, a reduction in hormone secretion from the ovaries. The woman's ovaries make most of the estrogen, although the adrenal glands and the fat cells do make a small amount. In fact, obesity is strongly correlated to lower hormones and lower levels of ovulation. Studies show us that weight loss reverses this condition. I love to tell you guys about things that can be reversed. Eating within your own personal calorie range can help you maintain hormonal balance and a moderate weight. I said moderate because you don't want to be stick thin. You see how much power you have to naturally improve your health and your hormones? We have the power. We just need to act. Check this study out. Now, before we go on, let me reveal 3 more obscure symptoms that are related to hormone changes to menopause that you need to know about, because you might be experiencing these and no one tells you that, yes, they're related to your hormones. Number 1 is poor oral health. Hormonal fluctuations can impact the tissues of your gums, the loss of bone around the jaw and your teeth, and that leads to changes in and around the face. A lot of women, of course, get a lip lift because this distance from the nose to the top of the lip increases. That's in a large part to bone loss and changes around the mouth. How about the next one? Vision changes. Menopause can also affect the eyes. 50% of you, in fact, in my community poll said you have dry eye. That's certainly related. And a third one that people don't often talk about when you go to your doctor is hormonal shifts and joint pain. Particularly shoulder pain. You get capsular contraction and a stiff shoulder. Many people get surgery for that to help move their shoulders because it just doesn't work like it used to and it gets stiff. That's hormone related. Number three, consume healthy fats. Now we talk protein, but I want you to differentiate these two. Think of them separately. Fats are that important to your hormones. And again, women seem to be afraid of this word. Men, they just eat whatever comes across the table. They take fat in, but women don't. Here is why you need them. You see, medium chain triglycerides, MCTs, some of you out there take MCT oil on and of its own, but they're unique fats that are less likely to be stored in fat tissue and more likely to be taken up directly by your liver for immediate use as energy, promoting increased calorie burning. Now you see me eating sardines a lot. Sometimes I'll post that on one of my stories. Yucky, right? Some of you are saying that. That's what you're thinking. However, sardines are nutritious and can be quite tasty. Get them in olive oil. Olive oil is great for us. You get that double hit. I'll tell you, it is a bit of an acquired taste, but start it. See what happens. They're packed with vitamin D, think bone, omega-3 fats, think your dry eye, and think anti-inflammation. These are fats that are essential to healthy hormone regulation, calcium, and even protein. In fact, one can of sardines is 23 grams of protein, which is, of course, essential for your muscles, your bone, your skin, and your cartilage. Now, here's what few will tell you. Omega-3s prevent cortisol levels from increasing during stress. Who doesn't have stress? High cortisol lowers your estrogen levels. Low estrogen causes your irregular periods, weight gain, hot flashes, night sweats, and more. So your healthy fats are found in your pure MCT oil, like many of you are taking, but also think avocados, almonds, peanuts, macadamia nuts, hazelnuts, fatty fish, olive oil, and coconut oils. Number four, get consistent, high quality sleep. There's a reason a couple weeks ago I put up a video and it was 30 minutes long, all about sleep. You want to go and watch that. Because no matter how nutritious your diet, no matter how consistent your exercise routine, no matter how many face procedures you get, none of it works without sleep. And I'm going to tell you why here. See, getting enough restorative sleep is crucial for optimal hormone health. Hormones, yes. Poor sleep is linked to imbalance in many hormones, including insulin, cortisol. Now you know what cortisol will do, leptin, ghrelin, and more. So here it is, another one, HGH, human growth hormone. Plus, your brain needs uninterrupted sleep to go through all of the sleep cycles. It's especially important for the release of your growth hormone. And of course, growth hormone comes in its peaks at night during sleep. Without sleep, you're not going to get a peak of that growth hormone. Here's the graph. What do you want to do here? Well, to maintain optimal hormone balance, you want to get at least 7 to 8 hours of high quality sleep at night. That's why my video on sleep is so important. Much of hormone production and regulation is actually within your control. But you'll want to now watch two more videos to make sense of this one. This one up here is absolutely important, and some bioidentical hormone replacement therapy. I sort through all of the myths and break it down into actionable advice. And one down here on adaptogens, natural hormone regulators, keep your skin and body beautiful, healthy, and vibrant.